All right, so continuing on with our multi-week look at Chapter 9, this week we are focusing in on blood spatter analysis and shooting analysis, or shooting reconstruction. So these two scenes kind of link together very well because they both deal with something called road mapping. So unlike, you know, the TV show Dexter, where Dexter did all the stringing of the scene, which, I mean, is true, yes, don't get me wrong. We really do string scenes, as you learned in, you know, the intro to CSI class, when we talked about biological evidence. Oftentimes, stringing the scene is not exactly used or needed, especially these days in our digital age, where we can take good high-resolution digital photos and then virtually string the scene using our computer drawing packages. So to accomplish this road mapping, what we end up doing is applying stickers and labels to the wall. So we end up with these really long stickers that are usually able to be attached to the wall, and oftentimes they come in like 1 or 2 foot sections, and so you got to kind of line up the pieces and stick them together, you know, piece by piece by piece, going up the wall. And so every block here is about 1 foot, and you can see the little tiny indicators are all like 1 inch. So this gives us a scale of how tall the wall is, how far across the wall is, and so we outline our area in the individual pattern zones with, you know, what we are looking for as it relates to a scale for that region. So here you have like your original pattern, and so now we've gone in and we've added in our feet and inch markers so that we can get everything laid out onto the wall. Once we've laid out those markers, then we begin the process of identifying blood droplets and identifying things that are unique to us so that those items will be measured. This will be gone into greater detail in the biological and trace evidence class. Dan Foyt or Ron Grofey, depending on which instructor you have, will go into a really good depth as to how we do the process of road mapping. And just want folks to basically understand what it is that we're doing without going into, you know, this is what you do, step one, step two, step three. Right now we're learning to walk. Later on, they will teach you how to run. So I'm just going to teach you the process here. So the idea is, you know, we've got our overall of the scene taken here, or at least an overall of this wall taken, with, you know, our four corners of the room. Now we're going to take a picture of the area that is interesting to us as it relates to multiple pieces of evidence. This would potentially be more like a mid-range type photo. Then, you know, we might get some close-ups of some of these things that we find interesting. So like this palm print, some of the spatter, the pattern that would be up here, this streak of blood here, this spatter pattern here. So the individual droplets that we identify as being interesting to us, we'll take and get close-up detail images of those, and then we start applying our rulers, and then we start applying individual labels for items that we find of interest, you know, item 1, item 2, item 3, item 4, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, as we go on through. Now, one of the other things that will take place while we're doing the blood spatter analysis is, you know, we would potentially like to find some of our area of origin. So it is not unheard of for us to take and, you know, document the scene with, you know, our labels on the wall, and then also take and start drawing on the wall and start drawing where we potentially would have our areas of impact. Now, again, this is looking at a two-dimensional world. We live in a three-dimensional world, but from time to time, you know, especially with some of the extensive cleanup that's going to have to be done, there's nothing wrong with going out and drawing on the wall and creating a two-dimensional visual of, okay, the pattern had to be, you know, in this area, and snagging a photo showing that. Unfortunately, you know, more and more of our investigative world is relying on some good visuals, so it might be the fact that you're having to do this in the two dimension, and if we need to go back and recreate it three dimensionally later, we will. But again, the whole idea of stringing is starting to kind of, you know, fall at the wayside. So really a big part of our tools here is going to be stickers, whether they are stickers labeling out directionality, which way is north, which way a blood droplet is facing. Went the wrong way. Oh, none of these images really show it per se. But sometimes, like in here where we're showing blood droplets, we might take and put one of those arrows showing that it's, you know, pointing this way, so blood droplet B, and you know, we might have things that are giving us our directionality. ABC, 1, 2, 3s, obviously the stickers with the rulers. We have stickers also that show that maybe there was a particular blood droplet that is not of interest to us for mapping the scene, but would be our droplet of blood used for DNA analysis or a fingerprint collected, say if we've got a visual, a patent print up there on the wall where somebody touched and leave that bloody handprint. So we got labels that say, you know, print removed, DNA collected here, sample collected here. It just depends on which manufacturer you get your kits from. We'll have some of these stickers, these annotations for us. The same is basically true with shooting reconstruction, except for instead of blood spatter, we end up with bullet holes. The thing that we add in then is our next step for our analysis is not going to be taking measurements of the bullet holes. You know, we take measurements of the blood droplets also. But what we're going to end up doing is now adding in the angles for our bullet trajectories. So we have our A, B, C, D logos, maybe even some arrows to make it easier to see the hole, depending on the surface you're on and your photography. Now we're going to add in some wooden dowels to measure those angles. We could use fiberglass dowels also, just again, depends on which kit you buy, where you're getting your accessories from. Now in a real good situation, what works very nice is the addition of the dowels is we add in little laser pointer pens. And if we have the laser pointer pens, what we can then do is utilize systems like photographic fog. You can use a vaporizer, so you can add humidity to the room to visualize the fog. There's also a process called walking the laser where you literally take a piece of paper and you stand kind of at the laser, your partner turns the shutter for the camera open, and you begin walking really quickly along the laser such that your body doesn't appear in the image. You get kind of, you know, ghosted out, but the laser appears because the piece of paper is picking up that laser and you're pointing it back at the camera. I've had very limited luck with walking the laser. I've just never gotten it to work out right. I think oftentimes one of the hang-ups with it is the fact that, you know, I'm trying to work the camera and, you know, trying to explain what I want to my partner to do. That hasn't worked. So then I have my partner working the camera and they start toying with settings on the camera, even though I say don't touch anything except for the shutter release. And I'm trying to do it. It is yet to really work for me. If some of you get it to work, congratulations, good for you. You know, but it's one of those techniques that you really have to have multiple people who've practiced this together to get to work. And unfortunately, I've never really had a chance to practice it with any of my coworkers because it just always seems like you're doing something different. So the photographic fog tends to work pretty well. The problem with the photographic fog, though, is by the time you start having too many applications of it, the room can get kind of blurry. These two photos here aren't too bad, you know, especially the nighttime here is really nice. It dissipates pretty quickly. And so you can do your longer shutter speed image where you can actually get some good imagery of the background, but then also still kind of snag that laser light in there. So, you know, no assignment with this week. It's kind of hard for us to ask you to go out and create blood spatter or create bullet holes at home. But I do want you to be thinking about this idea of road mapping, and again, too, because the biological and trace evidence is really where we explain the whole process of road mapping, the detailed nuances. I just wanted you to be exposed to the idea here and understanding the tools that we'll use. It's still the same process, overall mid-range close-up. So what we end up doing is you know, again, locking in that scene and then kind of focusing in on where the patterns are, and then individual pieces of those patterns, the individual blood droplets or the uniqueness like a handprint, a palm print, or otherwise. So for this week, just worry about the discussion question in your online quiz. Otherwise, I will talk to you again next week.